This is Jay Krishnamurti's fourth discussion with teachers at Brockwood Park, 1980.
Have you a nice time in India?
Yes, sir.
Good. Anything you want to discuss?
Could we make the circle smaller again with those two chairs there?
Oops, just
what should we talk about?
You said you've got some A-level questions.
What?
You said you've got some A-level questions.
I don't think I said that. I thought I said that as you give A-level and O-level to the students, you should have some A and O-level questions too, answers.
Could we talk about sorrow, sir?
Is that a problem to you? Yes? No, be quite impersonal about all these matters when we ask questions. I'm not trying to make it personal at all. Let's be simple about these matters. Do you really want to talk about sorrow? If you do...
I would have rather talked about whether it's possible to get a cohesive movement from the whole group.
What?
I would rather explore whether it's possible for us to get a cohesive movement from the whole group.
I wonder how you're going to do it. How you can have a one mind. See the same thing together. How would you set about it? If you and I living in the same house, as a husband and a wife or whatever it is, how would you bring about an agreement or having the same outlook as a man and a woman, how would you set about it? May I, would you please have a dialogue with me or should I talk to myself? I can, if you wish it. There you are in you and I, we seem to be talking at different levels. You may be higher, I may be lower. We seem to be not together in any, almost in anything. And it seems so important that when one is living in the same environment, same house, same doing things together, that there should be a kind of looking at things through the same window, without becoming narrow-minded, bigoted, and shallow. How do we set about it? If you were my wife or husband, my friend, I would ask you, look, is this really what we want? Or we are so deeply entrenched in our own narrow groove, in our own behaviors, attitudes and values that we don't seem to be able to break through. So I would start with my friend. He said, let's talk about it. Let's investigate it. Should we do that? Would you like to do that? The art of investigation is quite difficult. There is an art to it. I've discovered it for myself after so many years, that there is a way of really investigating, not as a scientist or a philosopher spinning a lot of words, but as a human being who seem to be incapable of working, thinking, feeling, observing the same thing together. So I must first find out if I really want to think or feel, observe with you. I want to. I say I really do want to. So if both of us want it, we shall begin to investigate how to observe together, how to think together, how to have one mind or one way of life. Right, shall we go on from there?
So in the school, we are pretty busy from morning to night. We are very busy. We have a lot of things to do, which seem necessary.
I was saying that to Dr. Mrs. Zimbalist and to Dr. Percheri last night, that you've got too many things to do. And so you have probably no time for this at all. Or perhaps you can give half an hour a day to it. Right?
Yes.
You could perhaps give 20 minutes, half an hour a day to it. Why don't we do it?
I don't think time is the problem.
Yes,
really.
All right. Time isn't the problem. How shall we investigate together why this barrier, why this lack of togetherness or way of thinking, investigating together, like two deeply interested persons? May I go into it, or will you just listen, or not take part with me? I would find out what it means to investigate. Why am I incapable of thinking or feeling or acting together with another? Why? Look, now, when I investigate, I never analyze. Right? I wonder if you can meet me on that point. I never analyze. What? Won't you come?
Yes.
No, sir, you say yes, but don't. No, this is quite serious. Don't say yes. Find out. I'm saying I never analyze. Why don't you tell me what the devil do you mean by it? Why don't you push and answer me?
So it maybe everyone isn't this way, but is there a tendency to something comes up, a question, and you want to think it out or come to a conclusion rapidly on your own without leaving it undecided, just looked at, and therefore you come to have a reaction, a conclusion, and that you defend? Is there not, or is there, I don't know, a reluctance to be tentative, to just look at things without coming to the answer, if there is one?
Yes. Look. Ask me a question. Talk about suffering. Miss Pratt says no, sorry, I'm not. We don't seem to think together. Or, yes, she said, when you left, ask an O-level and A-level question. You see, there are two interests here, right? Right? Or you have other interests. Now, which is important in this? My interest, your interest, or what? Tell me, please, come and join me.
But one interest doesn't preclude the other necessarily.
You say that. She says it does. So, she's not going to listen to you. She has a role. She wants to put A-level and O-level question from me. And you are concerned about suffering. So, what should we do? These two human beings demand two different things.
But investigating Miss Pratt's question or Shakuntala's question, isn't that really the same thing? Does it matter what question you investigate?
Which is what? Investigation matters.
Yes.
Not my question. No. First, let us learn. I'm not teaching you, please. Let us find out what it means to analyze, to investigate. Shall we?
Yes.
No, don't, please, when I say shall we must do it together. Otherwise, what does it mean to investigate? Would you tell me? Let's pool all our opinions about it. What does it mean to investigate? Not like a detective, not like a analyst. What does it mean to you to investigate?
Usually it means that we look at something, we see the various parts of it and how they are interconnected and how they move together.
Which means what? Tell me a little more about it. I want to investigate which is the best car for £5,000. And I go to various.
You
follow?
In part. You collect your facts.
Yeah, talk, discuss, ask people, with so on, till I have all the facts and I choose. There's one kind of investigation.
But you don't really investigate a psychological sort of fact in that way.
No, that's one way of investigating.
Yes,
isn't it?
But that's more in the nature of an analysis of it.
Yes. Now I want to investigate into some. Right? How shall I proceed? I want to go into it either for intellectual amusement or I want to go into it to find out why I suffer. What is the root of it? And I begin to inquire into it, right? Right? Now, how do you do it? How do you inquire into your anger or jealousy or enmity?
Well, one looks at these feelings.
You go into it, sir. Don't do it. Let's do it. Don't just say one looks at the feelings. Go, move with it.
And one looks at the thoughts which are associated with it, and the interplay between the thoughts and the feelings.
I don't see how, Krishnaji, that it's an impersonal thing, the investigation. No? And at the same time, it's an impersonal thing, as you say, nothing personal. And yet at the same time, it's from within you and your sorrow or your anger, that you're investigating.
Yes, I'm asking, Mrs. D., how do I set about inquiring into something which I feel very strongly about? Sorrow, anger, whatever it is. What do I do with it? You understand my question?
So when we're investigating an object, a tree or something, then we know what it is that we are looking at, but if it's something like salt,
that's fairly simple, sir.
We're not even sure whether what it is to look at. To
look, sir, I suffer. How do I investigate through that whole movement?
Now, what do you mean when you say you suffer? What does it mean to say?
Oh yes, I'll tell you what it means to suffer. I'm very lonely. I depend on somebody. And I feel when I depend on somebody, it makes me uncomfortable. I don't like it, but I depend. I'm attached. And that makes me anxious. And that anxiety goes on the rest of my life, right? So I say, how am I to investigate that anxiety?
I think it starts from the moment that you notice that you are suffering.
Yes, I've noticed it, sir. I'm anxious.
An investigation starts there, the moment
you
notice.
I'm doing it. Do help me. I so told you, I'm attached to somebody, and in that attachment there is fear, anxiety, wanting to be free from that attachment, and there is this, you follow, this battle going on, struggle, of which I may be conscious or unconscious. If I am conscious, then I begin to wriggle myself, I don't like it. Or I like it and I put up with it. If I don't like it, how should I proceed to investigate into something like anxiety?
Sir, is the investigation very different from, say, looking at a plant? Except that what you're looking at is actually happening in you. You're
yes,
not
that
putting it away and saying, I'll look at it and understand it. You are feeling it.
Yes.
And you are watching the motions the mind goes through with that feeling, with that whatever it is. So that you're not being too objective that it becomes intellectual.
I understand all that.
Isn't that it? It's like feeling a pain.
Yes.
In your body.
You are just describing it.
Well,
I'm asking you, if I may, most politely, respectfully, move from there.
Doesn't that begin to reveal?
Move.
If you don't pull
yes,
away?
It reveals. Move. Keep going, don't see the truth and stop there.
If you suddenly realize that you felt that way for a very long time, and you don't want, you see the limitation and the stoppage at that point.
You see, wait a minute. You just now say, I have felt it for a long time. You understand what you're saying?
Yes, you've gotten to, you've overlooked it.
No, no, just stop there. Please, I'm investigating. Forgive me. You said I have had it for a long time. What does that indicate?
One hasn't investigated.
No, no, what does that indicate? Do go into slowly, please. I've had anxiety for a long time. What does that indicate? What did that show? The very first realization that I've had it for a very long time.
I've been asleep for a long time.
What's that?
I've been asleep for a long time.
No, no, there's something much more to it. Go into a little. We are investigating. Move.
It has become a habit, a pattern.
He said that.
Doesn't it mean that you're not observing pattern anxiety?
What's that?
Does it mean that you're not observing the pattern anxiety?
No, no. Do it. You see, you're... All right, I'll wait. I'm asking, what does it indicate, which is beginning of investigation, what does it indicate that I've carried a burden for so long?
At least I've become very conscious of that.
What's that?
At least I've become conscious that I'm having
that. You have become conscious. You have become conscious now and realize that you have carried it for a long time. What does that show to you? You understand my question?
It shows that all kinds of things occur that we're unaware of.
One thing at a time, sir. One thing, I'm taking this. I've suddenly realized that I've carried a burden for a very long time. The burden of anxiety. Right? And I suddenly realize I've carried it. What does it indicate to me in my investigation into anxiety?
Passivity towards it.
Doesn't it indicate something about the nature of the brain that we would assume these burdens and carry them without noticing them?
So let's think about it before jumping to, before you answer quickly, if I may request you. What does it indicate?
Might it indicate that I've been carrying a burden for a long time? And I might ask myself, am I carrying this burden now? And it seems
to me, it indicates, I immediately ask, have I other burdens?
Mm-hmm.
You see, you understand my question?
Yes.
I've come to the realization that I've carried this burden. And he said, by Joe, have I got other burdens? Why? Come on, sir, I'm investigating. Have I other burdens of which I'm unconscious? And why has this burden showed itself? I wonder.
It also indicates, doesn't it, that I push my burdens out of consciousness if I can.
No, Maria, don't go into, please, go step by step. I realize I'm anxious, and it is a burden. I said, well, it is a burden that I've carried a long time. I have been wounded from childhood, and suddenly when I'm 50 or 80, I realize I've been wounded. And I said, but Joe, I've had it for a long time. Huh? What does that indicate to me? You're missing.
So if I approach this question with a motive, then my inquiry won't come to that point that there may be other burdens. It will already be trying to get, I think this is what you were saying, that it won't allow the investigation to follow in an intelligent manner like that, to see other burdens, when
right,
in fact your motive...
Have you, realizing that you have one burden,
yes.
Have you realized you have other burdens?
Usually we don't, we stick to that burden.
No, I'm asking you, madam, investigate, move.
I would think we know that we have a lot of burdens and know it very well, but we don't deal with it.
Huh?
We know very well that we have all kinds of burdens, but we push them under the rug.
Yes, we keep relieving.
So I push them all under the rug,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
No, I'm lifting the rug.
Yes. There they are.
No, you're not investing, you're just repeating the same thing again. That's what I'm objecting to.
But we seem to be able to deal only with one burden
no,
at a time.
No. Surely you have not only one burden.
No, we have many, but we
so
seem
wait,
to.
Wait, madam. Do you realize that you have many burdens?
Isn't it one burden? Isn't it one burden in point of fact? Isn't it one burden? I mean, you may see one point of it, as it were, one head of it, or one manifestation of it, but actually it's one burden.
So what do you do? I have this burden of anxiety. It just revealed its head to me. Now, how shall I proceed with it? I'm investigating it, do you understand, sir? I'm exploring the movement of it. I'm going with it.
I think it's difficult, though, because usually what happens is that you will then explain why you have the anxiety, and that doesn't really help. And you sort of get stuck after that. You say, well, I have anxiety. And you can point to reasons why you have it.
Yes.
But then those, you know, if you explain it, then that doesn't help with the anxiety. You still have the anxiety.
Aren't those not the real root of it, just the surface? Mm-hmm.
Yes, but somehow one doesn't seem to know how to get to the root of something.
I think the investigation is a game that we play, but really the motive is there initially, and the investigation is a game to try and get rid of the suffering.
That's what it's like. We've allowed it to become.
Mm-hmm. So could I, occasionally, one sees that there are these burdens. And one is shaken. And because the whole structure which we've built for ourselves is a house of cards, which just, it's...
No, sir.
And we don't investigate it.
And now, let's investigate it, sir. You're...
But I don't, it's how you investigate. This is what I don't understand, is how you... You see, we have a method of investigating other things, which we all know. But how to investigate something like anxiety, I think, I mean, it's, one gets into a difficulty.
Why not?
Well, I'm so involved in anxiety, it becomes
I'm
very
involved
difficult.
In it. I'm in it, right? I'm entirely caught up in anxiety.
So
right?
How do I investigate?
I'm going to... all right, what will you do?
That's why I
don't give it up so quickly.
Well, normally I walk around it rather than.
You see, it's very interesting. I realize I'm anxious, and also I realize that I've carried this anxiety for many, many years. Right? Now, I want to see what has happened. Why my mind has carried this thing. You understand?
It occurs to me that these so-called burdens give me self-importance.
Beg pardon?
These so-called burdens give me self-importance.
Oh, there are burdens which are important and burdens which are not important.
They make me feel important.
Are burdens, are not all burdens important?
No, she's saying all the burdens make me feel important.
You see,
self-importance, not that the burdens are, but that they lend a certain importance to the self.
Or an identity.
If I carry a burden for 50 years, I said, what? Why have I carried it? Right? Either I have carried it because I was unconscious of it, or it has not become a habit. It is there. To something that's there, it can't be a habit. Yes? I'm glad I said that. Now go and attack me. Attack me.
What does that mean?
Are you saying it's not a habit, sir?
No.
Are you saying it's not a habit because something that is a habit...
What is a habit?
Habit is something that's repeated mechanically.
Either you consciously have begun to do it regularly, cleaning your teeth in a particular way, and after a week it has become a habit. But the burden is not a habit.
Is it deliberate? Is it deliberate?
No.
You're saying that whatever causes the burden is still causing the burden. It isn't just because you've fallen into it.
I won't. You see, you're using these words and then getting away with them. I'm objecting
well,
being using
you
words.
What you mean by
I'm
that.
Going to, but you jump on me. But you don't join me, you see. All right, I'm going to it. I'm anxious. And I suddenly realized that I've carried this thing for many, many years. First of all, why? Why have my mind put up with it? You understand my question? Are you following me? Why? Answer me. Why has your mind or anybody's mind allow this burden to be carried?
Because we did not know how to throw it away.
No, madam, you're not.
Now, if you've just realized you've carried it for a long time, if you realize it now, that means you haven't realized it before.
You have realized it. Look, Miss Porter, you have realized. May I talk to you?
Yes.
You have realized it, that you're carrying a burden. Hmm? And also you realize that you've carried for many years or days. Now, why does the mind do it? Why does it allow a thing to be continued?
Isn't it?
You're not asking.
Not to allow it means you're aware of it, right? If you're not aware of it...
Look, go into it. You investigate.
It hasn't really allowed it. It's tried its level best to get out of it.
What?
So, we've usually tried to, you know, when we're anxious or... It's not that we've wanted it or... We've tried to, one thing or another, to avoid it or get away from it. But it hasn't worked.
Is that what you're doing?
Yes.
That you're anxious and your reaction to that is to escape from it.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And you heard this poor chap talking every day, don't escape from it. Right?
Well, one also realizes that one really can't escape from it because...
So?
I mean, it comes back, so you know you can't...
You see, you're not answering. All right, go to it your own way. Then what happens? You can't escape from it. You can't suppress it. You can't avoid it. You can't overcome it, right? Then what do? Put up with it? Apparently you do.
But the escape sometimes seems to be an action.
Yes, all that, agree. So you
that we don't see, we believe the action is going to...
Yes, madam, you've said all that. So you say, well, I won't escape from it. So it remains, right?
Yes, you don't put up with it either, actually.
Yeah, it's there.
Yes, it's there.
What do you do then? Proceed. See, my mind, I won't like, you see, when I discover something like that, anxiety, and I realize it has been going on for a long time, I say, what has happened? Why has my mind put up with this? Right? You don't ask that
question. You see, that's a new factor you brought in, Krishna.
What?
That's a new factor you brought in. And that new factor is a possible means of stopping it and saying, I'm going to look at this. I see that I've been burdened with it all this time and I have put up with it. I've said that's what life is. And because of the living of life, we escape into all the roots that we can, like here, with doing forevermore. You see?
I have been through all that. I don't even...
But we're creating the circumstances to perpetuate that.
I don't even put that question. Am I escaping? I've escaped. But I'm much more interested, you may be wrong, I'm much more interested why the mind has put up with it.
Isn't the mind still trying to...
It feels secure. Now, why don't I ask the question? That's what happens.
I'm asking you.
You're asking the question, but the mind, or my mind, won't ask that question. If it asks the question,
I'm going to answer it, sir. Investigate. You see, you're waiting for an answer. But I want to investigate. I say, look, my mind has put up with this burden for 20 years. Why?
Does it have any say in the matter?
Huh?
Does the mind have any say in the matter about
it? Oh, it is saying it now. It is saying now. Say, why have I put up with this thing?
So doesn't the mind hold on to some hurt or some thing that it cannot deal with and solve? And therefore it holds it like a
You
wound.
See, that means what?
The mind is
No, that means what?
It's a means of identity.
No, so look, that means what? I can't solve sorrow. I can't solve anxiety. I can't solve this, that. So there are lots of burdens in my mind which are not solved at all. So what is doing that to my mind? You don't meet my question.
Can we go
it
back?
It is deteriorating the mind.
How long have you had this suffering?
Probably since I was born.
Oh no. Come, you see. All right. Then why have you put up with it? This is not, I'm not bullying or agreeing. I'm just asking generally, why does one put up with it? Why do you put up with it?
Well, you see, everybody else is in the same boat.
So, that's not an answer.
Sir, it would mean... It would
For
mean,
God's sake.
It would mean attacking and perhaps giving up things which we don't want to give up.
So?
So the consequences seem worse than the anxiety.
You've said something, you've gone, you see, you're too... So, you put up with all these things because... Why? You have said something. which is, if it let go of this, it has nothing. So all this you put up, is it because to be occupied with them?
Well, I would have said that we're occupied with other things, and we don't want to give those up. And the anxiety and the sorrow are the consequence of trying to maintain those things.
And the sense of self is deeply involved with
those. Don't go back to self. You're not investigating. You're stating.
Well, I feel I'm investigating. And perhaps that's the difference, that I don't know how to do it.
I'm doing it for you. I'll show you. I've carried this burden for a long time. I suddenly realize I've carried it. I say to myself, now, are there any more? I see there are many more. Then I say to myself, why has the mind carried these things? Right? I'm investigating. Why has the mind carried these things? Is it indifferent to all this? You understand? Is it... If it is concerned, it doesn't know how to solve them. And so you say, I don't know what to do with them, I'll put up with it.
So I'm not sure that we actually put up with it. Every time you feel anxious or sorrow, you don't put up with it, you try and do something about it, only we've probably never really investigated. You cover it over with something, but you're not at that time putting up with it. And in fact, at the time, you think you've solved it until it comes up again the next time.
Yes, the mind tries to analyze.
So you keep on repeating?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yes.
So what did that mean?
It doesn't know how to investigate it properly.
So what will you do? From whom are you going to learn?
Not from anyone.
I'm your teacher, A-level and O-level teacher. I'm going to teach you to investigate. At the end of an hour, you're going to... I'll pass on the paper, you'll answer it. See, you're not... You're stating, you see, you're not probing. All right. Let me go on. May I have for a little and then you can see. I realize I've got many burdens. Some hidden, some open, some so deeply concealed I even don't know them. But they are burdens. And I say to myself, why? Why does the mind, which is fairly alert about other things, you understand? Why does it carry all these burdens? Just answer my question, that question. Would you?
If a burden is generally a non-desirable thing, as a mind...
No, I'm using the word burden. No, please stick to that word.
Yes,
don't you?
Yes.
If we both agree, we can use another word.
No, but a burden is something which is not... useful, desirable. It's
burden is a burden.
A burden is a burden. And if the mind is carrying that, it must obviously be in confusion.
You see what you have changed it into? You have stated that, sir. Have you investigated?
How can a mind that's... why else would a mind carry a burden?
Would you say then, the mind itself is a burden?
Yes.
Don't say that.
If it's causing the burden, possibly, but is it? What is causing the burden?
This is a class, I'm the professor. So please, would you kindly listen? And then you can ask me questions afterwards. Right? Right? That the easiest thing will be. your experts say. So I'm going to. I'm anxious, I've got knee burdens, and I've carried them for 50 years. And I say, why? Why has my mind, which is very supple about many, many things, supple, quick, can react quickly, why has my mind carried these things? Is it because, I'm just investigating, is it because I am lazy? Is it because I feel that they are insoluble and it requires a great deal of energy to solve them, therefore, and I haven't enough energy, therefore I let it drift? Is that it? Now, please investigate with me, I'm going to. Or, if I hadn't those burdens, what is there? You understand my question? Perhaps those burdens make up my mind. Are you following? So if I don't have those burdens, my mind would be rattled, would be confused, would be lost. Is that it? No, I'm asking myself, I'm investigating.
The mind is confused and rattled with the burdens.
What?
The mind is confused and rattled with the burdens too. I
understand. Is it? Or is it rightly confused about the burden? You see? Investigate. Please don't stop there. I asked you a question. You said mind is confused apart from the burdens.
No, I'm not saying apart. I'm saying with the burdens.
So, are the burdens causing confusion?
Well, the burdens are causing disorder.
Anxiety? No, don't go after disorder. I'm sticking to one thing. Are these burdens? Why have you carried these burdens? You go on answering that first.
I think it's because the mind thinks it can solve the problems of the burdens.
Oh, so?
The mind thinks it can solve the problems created by the burdens.
So, you haven't been able to solve the problems which burdens carry. Mm-hmm. Is that what you're saying? Mm-hmm. So what?
So the mind is incapable of dealing with these problems. The mind itself.
So we've said that, sir.
But in the future.
No, we have said that, sir. Is it because one is incapable of solving the burden, solving the weight of these burdens, so you just let them drift? Carry on with them. We've said that. You see, you're not paid. Next is, I said, if there were no burdens, would the mind invent a new burden?
We somehow seem to need something to think about.
That's what I'm saying, my lady. That's what I'm saying. Because the mind wants to be occupied with something, right? So, burdens may be its occupation. You understand what I'm saying? Like a person who is hurt, who is wounded psychologically, carries it all his life. Because he's occupied with it. It gives him some kind of satisfaction.
But, sir, are burdens the only thing that the mind can occupy itself with?
I didn't say that, sir. There are dozens of things.
But if burdens aren't the only thing, then why does the mind choose burdens to be occupied with?
I have not been able to explain myself. If these burdens of which my mind is now conscious, and I'm asking, why has it carried for so long? You don't answer that question.
Well, surely the burdens are the result of the mind, created by the mind.
All right. Created by the mind, and the things that it has created, it carries along. I've said this.
Yes, but as long as it goes on in the same way, manufacturing.
So what does that indicate? What does that indicate? My anxiety is created by my thought, which is my mind, and that mind, having created this sense of anxiety, keeps on nourishing it. Keeps on giving fuel to it all the time, thinking about it. Oh, I'm anxious, I'm lonely, I'm hysterical, and it keeps on.
But it's unclear why.
We are investigating, so you are not investigating, that's what I'm objecting.
Why should an occupied mind be a burden?
What?
If the mind is going on doing that, why does that become a burden?
Because it's not free. It's going round and round this room.
Why is that not a habit?
You see, you haven't, you've gone back to something else. You stick to this, really.
But so, it feels like a habit. I mean, it feels like that's the generating factor that keeps it going round.
So your mind carries on this. Either doesn't know what to do with them, or if it drops one burden, it picks up another burden. Or you say, well, I don't know anything, for God's sake, forget about the burden, let's get on. That's what you're doing.
Sir, I might not be investigating, but these burdens still seem to be the side effects of things which we do like, of pleasures, of things which we pursue.
No, sir, I'm not talking about that. I'm only talking about one thing.
But the anxiety seems to come as the consequence.
Oh, it doesn't matter. The feeling of anxiety, maybe a consequence. That feeling has existed in me for 30 years. And I said, well, why do I carry this thing out for 30 years?
So hasn't the mind become that burden after such a long time? I mean, if one says, I'm carrying that burden...
You see, sir, we're not thinking together. Right? You're thinking... See?
Well, sir, we're trying to investigate something. Now, could you say why you just said that? Because each one of us is... presumably looking in themselves at this subject.
I wonder if you are.
Why do you say that?
I question.
Why?
I'm not saying, please just carefully listen to what I say. I question. It doesn't mean I doubt. I want to know if you're really looking.
Well, how do we prove it? Show you that.
Huh?
You see, if
I'm asking, are you really looking at your anxiety?
Well, can we examine then what we're doing? Because obviously, from what you indicate, it is wrong.
What?
It is, what we're doing is not investigation.
No.
Can
we clarify the inadequacy of what we're doing if we are, because it seems to be inadequate? I would offer this for what it's worth: is that we have the anxiety and the burden. We also have a certain mental apparatus which normally solves problems or deals with problems as they arise. And with that mental apparatus, we tend to, if we do approach it at all, we approach questions like anxiety, but they don't yield to that apparatus. They don't yield to that functioning.
Why don't we use it?
Well, I don't. It seems as though that apparatus doesn't work. I mean, in our mind, it's generally a fairly rational, exploratory, analytical kind of apparatus, and it somehow doesn't quite meet, it doesn't meet the anxiety directly. It meets it as sort of there's a gap between the anxiety and the looking at the anxiety. There's a gap there.
And isn't the apparatus the thing that is generating the anxiety? The same.
Well, it may be. Could be. I'm not sure.
Well, the same instrument is at work.
Could be.
But sir, could you? You're asking us to do something. We are trying to do something. Where is it not investigation?
Are you asking me? Oh, what did you say? I was saying,
we are trying to learn what investigation is. And each of us is presumably looking within themselves. And you say we're not investigating. And I'd like to understand.
You know, what does investigation mean? The world. What does investigare, what does that mean?
To step in.
Somebody tell me.
To step in.
Huh?
To step in.
To step in. Hmm? All right, to step in. Are you stepping into the movement of it? Stepping into the current of this feeling of anxiety? See, my mind refuses to have any burdens. The burdens create a problem, right? Right?
You're speaking personally now. Yeah.
It creates problems.
Well, that's no good to us.
Lisa, wait just a minute. I won't wait. Let me allow me for 2 seconds. And I say, look, I want to find out why human mind carries these burdens. You follow? Why?
I don't have my burdens. I don't know what's going to be there.
Nationalism is a burden. Right? No? Huh? Nationalism, with its technological knowledge, plus technological knowledge, is a great danger in the world at the present time. Now, is there a nationalistic feeling in me? I want to find out. See, it's a very good subject, anxiety. And if we can together investigate into it, see what the cause of it, what the consequences of it, analytically, intellectually, verbally, and see if that anxiety can end. Right? That is investigation. That's about, I start with it and halfway give it up. I want to find out if it can be ended.
investigate it analytically doesn't seem to work. So, I mean, that's one of the difficulties we seem to be having, is that our usual mode of investigation is analytic.
All right, analyze.
In a sense, you can explain all sorts of things.
Let's analyze. Analyze what is anxiety. And that's just it, sir. That's my whole point.
So what's the difference between...
She raised a question. She said, please talk about suffering. Will she go to the very end of it and see if it can be ended? Or she halfway she gets tired and goes off to somewhere else. I'm not saying you do. I'm just asking. When you start a thing like suffering, do you want to go to find out the whole movement of it and see if it can be ended? Right? Do you? Like anxiety, which is great, which is one of the things in human mind. Do you want to see what it is, the whole concept, and end it?
Somehow we don't seem to be able to stick with it.
Huh?
Somehow one doesn't seem to be able to stick with it. You sort of start off.
Do it. Not somehow we can't do it. Put your mind to it. You wanted to go to India, you took the trouble, you went. Here, apparently, we can't do that.
Can we look at why we can't do it?
I can give a dozen reasons.
There must be one reason, though, because this is what happens all the time.
Because we don't know what to do. We are waiting for somebody to tell us what to do.
I'm not so sure, because we do start off, Krishnaji, we're really troubled by something.
Are we waiting for somebody to tell you? Why can't you do it yourself?
Well, we do. We start doing it. And then, as she said, something happens to stop us,
no,
but we don't know
something
what.
Something doesn't happen. You don't pursue it.
Are you saying we're not...
He says something, and we discuss that.
No, I mean, if you're doing it for yourself, if you're feeling anxious...
If I'm doing it myself, this is where I proceed.
You do, but we're talking about us.
But
well, you say
this is...
that you don't want to be it. You won't put up with that.
No, I see, I think mind must be, it's like mind being in a prison and not being in a prison. Those are two entirely different states. It's not a reaction. Freedom is not a reaction.
Is that the trouble then? Is it a reaction with us and that's why we never finish it?
I don't know. You haven't got, probably you've never, never gone into it sufficiently.
Also, perhaps you've never been caught in these things.
Then will you please learn?
But why, sir, after all the years that we've spent looking at these things, have we never investigated one of these things fully?
I don't think we have.
But why haven't we?
Because of course, 1 year, you're too occupied, you've got so many things to do, this you give half an hour or no time, you're too tired at the end of the day and so on, you just...
But even when I've had lots of time,
you have
I still
now.
Have not investigated...
So look what we have done, we have spent an hour and 10 minutes, we haven't started investigating.
So do we really know what it means to investigate?
Huh?
As if, do we really know what it means to investigate?
I can't hear.
Do we really know what it means to investigate? She said.
He said, to step forward. To plunge in, to enter into the movement of anxiety. Go with it, find out.
But maybe could we look at Scott's question, because time is not a problem now. We've come here together to discuss this. And yet we still seem to be unable to...
You're not discussing. Each person is saying something different.
But we all think that we're investigating, aren't we?
I don't know.
Actually, I think the thing that we're saying that's all the same is that we really don't understand what it is to investigate. I mean, I think we all feel that.
Now, what do you expect me to do? Huh? At the end of the...
Well, just now you said, listen to me and learn.
But you don't even do that.
But Krishnaji, but you with respect, I mean, huh?
You're asking us constantly, what are you doing? What are you saying?
All right, I won't even ask.
I'll just go.
I'll just go on, as I generally do, and I hope you'll listen. I want to find out why this burden has been in me for so many years. That's my chief question, you understand? That's my chief investigation, nothing else for the moment. Why have I carried that? Is my mind involved so much with so many problems, with so many burdens, that it has become totally indifferent? You understand? I'm just asking myself, is that so? I have sorrow, I have all the burdens, and I don't know what to do with them, I put up with them, so I carry it. But if I knew what to do, would this burden be dissolved, thrown away? Will knowledge, analysis, explanations help me to get rid of this thing? So what am I to do? You understand my... Right? Am I moving? Are we meeting each other somewhere? I have this problem of anxiety. The consequence of anxiety, I get depressed. I get angry. I defend. I'm always nervous, anxious, fearful. And the consequences of all that we all know. So I say now, why am my mind has put up with this thing for so long? Right? Now with me, this is where the difference is. I wait. You understand? I wait for it to reveal itself, the answer. I am not telling the answer. I wonder if am I making this clear? I wait, I look, and I'm waiting. Not, I don't want an answer, I don't want an explanation. I'm waiting to see the truth of it. You follow? So then I say, what is the state of my mind that's waiting? Look, what is my state? Do I want to end it? Do I want to escape from it? Do I want to somehow crawl out of it? Which means, I don't like it, you follow? So I have a motive with regard to it. So I'm already, the motive has become the burden. I wonder if you see. I'm asking because I may jump, so please. So motive is the burden. Right? Now, why have I a motive? Is there anything in my mind, in my life, anything without motive? Or am I living always with motives? Right? they see I am. Now, is that, is it a habit, like cleaning the car or cleaning the teeth, is it a habit, or if it is a habit, it has no vitality? I don't know if I made that clear. Right? I must ask this question. If it is a habit, it's a mechanical, it has nothing. But motive is not mechanical. It's very, very strong. It's a driving force in my life. So, why is motive a central factor in my investigation? You follow? Why has motive become so important in my life? Is it like a rudder in a sea? Because without a rudder, I get lost. So is motive a rudder? Which means what? That motive implies a direction, an end, which means I must reach that end, which is I am becoming all the time. So I see where there is a motive, there is this constant becoming.
Yes.
Clear? Right. Why has humanity been driven by this? Becoming. Priest becomes a bishop becomes a pope and so on. Psychologically, I must gradually achieve. So is this psychological movement of becoming the result of becoming in the world? Is it related to that becoming? Because in that becoming there is safety. In physical becoming, a better job, better position, so on, there is safety, protection, security. So have I carried that same mentality into the psychological field? I wonder if it is. So, why has my mind done that? Which means I'm always anxious. I don't, right? Because I'm climbing, and I'm asleep, somebody may be faster, so I may be kicked aside, so I'm watching, anxious, envious. So why am I doing this? So I say, is it that I want psychological security? Right? That is the central point. So I've discovered that through anxiety, you understand, I've gone very far to find out my whole existence psychologically is based on the demand for security. So is there such a thing as psychological security? Right? There isn't. So, wait. There isn't. So, what has told me there isn't? Go on, tell me. What has told me that in seeking security, all the problems arise, and I'm seeing that there is no security. Now, we'll go into that. Now, we follow how for me, what is investigation? I will go to the very end till security is completely out of my mind. Security means attachment. Attachment to something or other, which is the same thing.
And that's illusory, isn't it? Because if you're attached, you can lose it. So where's the security in that?
So there's corruption and all the rest of it. Now, may I ask now? I've finished up to now. May I ask now, have you investigated with me into the anxiety? Why has my mind not seen that anxiety and security are very closely related? Why didn't I see that immediately? You follow me? Why have I to go through all those steps to come to that point? I wonder if why didn't my mind see immediately the relationship? Not as a conclusion, but as a fact, inner fact. So my analysis becomes futile, and remains merely verbal and intellectual if I don't grasp the thing from the very beginning. Am I making myself clear some more? Okay, I haven't.
So if you grasp it from the very beginning, isn't that the end of it? I mean, you've seen the whole thing. What is, if you grasp it...
Why don't I see it at the beginning?
And not go through all the rest?
Huh?
And not go through all
to all this mess. See, your mind's up to you. See, you raised a question of suffering. Do you really want to go into the very end of it and end it? Did you kindly answer?
Said yes. The fact that we're listening.
No, I'm not sure. She raised that question.
Krishnaji, I feel that I want to go into this question of sorrow, but I, for one, I'm not sure whether I'm capable.
So how do you get capacity? When you say, I'm not capable, you have stopped. But if you say, what is capacity? That's investigation. What is capacity? It's a goal. Either you have capacity through experience, capacity being skilled, being efficient, capable and so on. So, do you say capacity comes through accumulation of knowledge?
No.
No, don't say no.
Well, I mean, it doesn't seem as though it works.
But the whole world is based on that, so don't say no.
Well, I mean, I've tried it.
A good carpenter, he's first an apprentice, works, and becomes a master carpenter. And then he's a good craftsman.
Yes, that's in the area of...
No, wait, sir. See, that's in the area of what?
Of learning a skill.
Of learning a skill. And at the end of 5 years or 10 years, he's capable. He has capacity. Now, so you say from that, after 10 years he's acquired the skill as a surgeon, because he's operated, he's learned, he's studied 7 years and 10 years in the hospital and so on, till ultimately he becomes a top surgeon, and which means he's had tremendous experience behind him. Which means he's accumulated great knowledge, and that knowledge is guiding his hands. And that knowledge, we say from knowledge comes capacity. Right? Mm-hmm. I don't know if you're interested.
Well, you see, I feel among us here, we've learned the skill, probably, many of us, to watch ourselves, which brings a certain seriousness, but this doesn't really seem to get to the bottom of the thing.
So that's what I'm asking, sir. Is capacity the result of knowledge?
Not in this field, anyway, only in the practical
sense. When you say not, you are denying the accumulation of knowledge which will give you capacity. Right? I learned shorthand for, it takes me 2 or 3 years, and I have capacity. That is, I've spent accumulating skill and all the rest of it, my head, and all that. So when I say no, it appears not, you are saying knowledge does not necessarily give capacity.
Only as far as technical things are concerned, it gives capacity.
Now, are you saying psychologically there's no capacity with us?
It seems that psychologically learning seems to prevent capacity, accumulating knowledge.
Does incapacity come when you apply? There are shorthand I've applied for 2 years. Right? Have I applied psychologically? Have I said psychologically anxiety? You follow? That is, have I the capacity to resolve that? Of course one has. But apparently...
But application there is different from accumulating knowledge.
Of course. So, do I bring that same mentality to this? We do. I don't know what to do. Moments say I don't know what to do, you are waiting to have capacity to what to do. Which means you are waiting for somebody or a learn, you follow? The same process.
That has given a vitality of a kind, at least to bring you to the threshold, so to speak. And you've seen the fact that some line that you pursued was false, or that whatever, it's very, very different for different people, but that they, the career that they were in was not right, or... You know, almost everyone has seen a fact of some kind, and that fact itself gives a certain, well, the seeing of that fact gives a certain vitality.
Yes, sir.
But that vitality, you see, is discontinuous. It doesn't. You saw that fact, but the seeing of that fact doesn't necessarily enable you to see others.
I'm not sure, sir.
Or does it? Perhaps it does. It gives a kind of confidence.
Have you ever asked that you don't want any capacity? No skill. To have nothing.
What would make you say that, sir?
What makes me say?
Or what would make anyone say that?
Nobody does.
At least things could come to you then.
Huh?
At least things could come to you then, rather than you impose on it.
Like, huh?
You could receive what there is to receive and work from that. You see, I think we're trying to answer things in intellectually when it's really not a question of it, you're living it. You're living it, and so you're trying to answer it in a wrong medium, so to speak.
Then what medium, unless one uses the world, it's a common language, what other medium is there? Except...
Well, if you have nothing, Krishnaji, you have nothing. You are receiving.
I personally have no experience, no way, no skill, nothing. Don't bother about me.
But you see, you can't say that because we are bothering about
you. Oh, yes, I can.
But you really can't say it.
I'm saying it.
But you ought to say
that.
I'm
saying it. Water has no scale. Water. The wind has no scale.
It has its lack energy. It has its changing lack energy.
I say it has no skill.
No.
Efficiency.
To live, you don't have to have skill.
No capacity, no experience.
Exactly. Which is the nothing, which you're saying. Can you meet life like that?
Yes, sir, I'm saying that all along. Best stop. It's 1 o'clock. Best stop, don't you?